Check. Check one. Check. Check. We'll let you finish the song. There you go. Well, good morning and welcome to SF NAS Online. It is great to see you this morning. This is a really weird setting for your pastor this morning. I'm used to at least having more than two people with me in worship. And we hope you're up and at 'em this morning, sitting around your dinner table with your computer or your iPad or your tablet open. Maybe your phone, getting ready to watch and to celebrate the Lord with us. A little different this morning. We're not doing music this morning. We were wondering how all of this was going to play out, and so we just took a break with our worship team this week, and we're going to play that on a week-to-week basis, but it is good to see you this morning, and we're glad to be with you. As we come to the Lord this morning, I want to share a word of prayer as we begin, and then we're going to take a few moments to talk about some of the things that are happening around us and how they affect us here at the church. So let's pray a word together this morning as we gather. Father, how good it is to come into your presence this day and to be able to celebrate our faith and you, our King of Glory. Lord, we ask this morning as we gather that you would be with us, that whether we're sitting in our living room, at our kitchen table, wherever we are today worshiping, that God, you would come to that place and that it would become a holy sanctuary where we could hear from you, where we could draw near to you, where we could worship you, Lord, in spirit and in truth. Watch over and keep us today and help us to have a great day as we celebrate you in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, lots is happening around us in the state of Kansas and here in Salina as we work through this COVID-19 pandemic. A number of things I wanted to share with you this morning just by way of information so that you have an idea of literally what's happening. Some may not have access to all the news sources that are good sources, so we're going to try to share with you a few things this morning before we jump into the Word. First of all, you need to know that Saline County, as well as the state of Kansas, is now under a stay-at-home order effective at 12:01 a.m. Tomorrow morning. That means a lot of things for a lot of people, but for most of us, it's not going to be as burdensome or difficult as we might seem. One of the things that I've been trying to tell people this week is celebrate what you've got. You know, it's easy to talk about all the things I can't do, all the places I can't go, all the stuff I want to do. But the reality is this, you're still blessed to be able to do some wonderful things. And just celebrate what you've got. Celebrate those moments that you get to share one with another. Celebrate those moments when you get to be at home. I was talking to Greg Long, one of our men this morning, and he works for Waste Connections. And he said, you know, people being home has been a little difficult in his world because they're cleaning house. And having to pick all that stuff up makes life a little bit difficult. But there are some really good things to this. Spring cleaning happens without stress because what else are you going to do when you have to stay at home? But I just encourage you to make the most of these moments. Spend some time with your family. Do some things if you have children at home that you more normally have time to do with your kids. And make the most of these moments. One of the things one of my feeds on my internet said to me this morning was, in these days when we are challenged to stay at home and reduce the stress and the normal pace of life and living, think about what you're going to put back in when you go back to life as normal. Because there are some things you and I are going to eliminate in these days that are not essential. They're things that we've just plugged into our world because they were there and it's been a part of us running on that hamster wheel. And maybe now we can slip out and be able not to have to be caught up in this time of difficulty. The stay-at-home order, a couple things that I wanted to share with you. A lot of people are asking, well, what exactly does that mean? From the state of Kansas, as well as Saline County, it means that you can go and get food, medicine, and other household necessities. You can still go to and from work at a business or organization that has essential function as identified by the state. You can also go to the doctor. We, if you're sick, we want you to do that. You can care for children, family members, or pets, or care for a vulnerable person in another location. So that means if you have to go check on mom or dad or grandma or grandpa or be over with the grandkids at their house while mom and dad go to work, you're still able to do that. And then you're also able to engage in outdoor activities, providing that you keep a minimum distance of 6 feet from one another and abide by a 10-person limitation. So that means you and your lovely can go for a walk, make her walk on one side of the street, you walk on the other. It'll be a great thing, and you can just have a wonderful time together. During this time, we want you to know that the church office is going to be open. We provide essential services in our community, and so we are one of those businesses as deemed by the state that will be able to be open. That doesn't mean that we're just going to have people flocking here. It just means that our office will be manned and that Pastor John and Don and I will be here through the week to provide pastoral support and care. Most of that is happening through the telephone. We are no longer able to access any of the hospital or the nursing homes. There are very few homes that we are going to visit during this time, but we'll be able to communicate with you if you touch base with us by phone or email or text, and we'll be glad to stay in touch with you. We also have an essential ministry here at the church of picking up groceries and medication for our church family age 60 and above. So those of you who fit in that category, so that you don't have to get out and be exposed with extra things. We'd love to have you get out and or get on the phone and call us and let us know what you need, what we can do to help, and how we can be a part of what's going on in your world. We're also going to be providing some internet services for students in our church that don't have internet at home. The Salinas School District is going to be providing all of our students in the district with Chromebooks, and if you don't have internet at home, mom and dad, you'll be able to have a place for your kids to do school. We have enough rooms here at the church to keep them cordoned off, and we'll crack the whip if we have to make sure they get their schoolwork done, but it's a place where they can come and do schoolwork with internet if you don't have that at home. Pastoral staff, we're going to be available. Pastor John and I are going to continue to be available to you for anything that you need. My phone's listed there on the screen today, as well as Pastor John. And feel free to call us, to text us, just to check in with us. If you have a prayer request, if something's going on that you need to share that we just need to pray for, we would love to do that. and just invite you to keep in touch with us as we go through these days. Today we have begun online Sunday school and Bible studies. If you go to our Facebook page or our app, and in particular, if you go to our app and today you click on the SF NAS during the COVID-19 pandemic, click on information and then click on today's date, there is a list with hot links to every one of our Sunday school classes. We've already had one Sunday school class this morning online, and that was great. And we have another one for our teens meeting at 11. Trudy Rathman's class is going to meet at 1. Our Hispanic congregation is going to meet online at 4 o'clock today. And then on Wednesday night, I will be having my regular Wednesday night Bible study at 6:30. There are links to all of those meetings on Zoom. And we encourage you to try to get onto Zoom before the meeting. You can go in and it'll load to your computer, and you'll be able to know that you're ready to go, so that when you click on that link, it'll take you right into those times together. As you need information or want to know what's happening around the church, there are two sources that we're going to keep updated every day. Our SF NAS devotional app, SF NAS Devos in your app store, that has links to just about everything that's happening in the church. There are ways for you to view the messages, a way for you to go and see the songs that we were going to sing this morning. You'll be able to get in there and sing along with those by video. There are places there for you to touch base and see what's happening in terms of our daily devotional times. All of those kind of things are going to be happening, and primarily through our app, but also we'll have links to get you there through our Facebook page. And we want to keep you in the loop. You will be receiving messages on our One Call system. And we're not going to try to burden you with a ton of them, but we will get its essential information to you. We want to thank you this morning for your continued stewardship. These are difficult days. And just as life is a little bit different at home, trying to figure out how you make everything work, life's a little bit different here at the church. When you have an empty sanctuary and you don't get to pass these on Sunday morning, it makes paying the bills a little bit difficult at the church. And so we've had to trust that our people would just respond, and the majority of you have done that, and we appreciate so much your continued stewardship in providing for the needs of the church. Three ways that you can give. Essentially, you can give online. There's a place on the app where you can give your tithes and offerings there. You can go to our website and click on the Give Now button. For those of you who've maybe never done that before and a little apprehensive, the online giving app is an extremely, extremely protected app. And so you don't have to worry about your personal information being lost or stolen there. It comes directly to the church when you give it, and is just a wonderful way to help you not have to worry about getting a check in the mail or dropping it by. You can do those things. You can write a check and stick it in the mail, or you can drop it by the church because we're here. But we just encourage your continued stewardship and thank you for all that you're doing. The last thing I want to say this morning before we look into the Word is that I want to encourage you in this time to stay spiritually focused. You would expect your pastor to say that. But one of the things that I'm concerned about is that when we move into times like this, when we're apart because of a pandemic or any other kind of thing, there is the tendency to develop habits that will change the way we do things in the future. Sociologists tell us that if you do anything 30 days in a row, you're going to develop a new habit, and it's going to be something that's ingrained in you and a part of everything that you do from that point forward. With that in mind, I'm just going to encourage you during this time to really stay focused in the Word. To take time every day to get into the Bible, to read, to study, to learn. One of the great ways you can do that is through our church app. If you go to our church app, you can click into the sermons and the Bible studies. Go to our Through the Bible reading program that we're doing. We've got a number of passages there that you can look at every day, as well as a devotional that I write to go with one of those passages every day. But I encourage you to get into the Word, to take time to be there, Take time to be intentional about it. Take time to study it, to ask questions. If there's questions that you have that maybe you just can't figure out, send a note to Pastor John or I. We'll be glad to dialogue with you, maybe call you in. We can have Bible study together. Any way that we can help to get you into the Word. I also want to encourage you to make sure that you take time to pray. The needs of our church are great during this time. We have a number of people who've been going through difficult issues of health, and we try to keep those prayer requests up on the one-call system. But we want to encourage you to pray. Pray for those needs that you know and the needs that you don't know. Folks in our community who may be struggling with the illness that's going around and all of the changes that it brings in people's lives. I also want to encourage you to pray for those who are in the hospital and those who are in nursing homes. At this time, they can't be visited. And so they're there and they're alone and there's nothing we can do to reach out to them. And it's a very difficult time for them. So pray especially for them and for your family as well. And then one last thing that I, well, actually two last things I want to say. Fellowship is one of the things that suffers during times like these. We're not able to get together. But there are ways that we can get together. And I encourage you to pick up your telephone and call people. Talk to them. Now, I'm a little old-fashioned here, but I'm just going to be honest and I'm going to say this. The tendency is for us, because we have the technology, to text people. We can get said what we want to say and we don't have to get caught in a conversation. But you know what? Texting during this time is incredibly impersonal. The one thing we need more than anything else right now is touch with others. And so I just encourage you to forget about texting and pick up the phone and call people, talk to people, share with people and let them know how you're doing. Find out how they're doing. Pray with one another on the phone. And if you have the ability to do that through FaceTime or one of the other social messaging groups where you can do video chat, I encourage you to do that, where you can look into the eyes of people and you can just share with them where you're at and find out where they're at and deal with those things. Just to help each other get along. Fellowship, I believe, is the best medicine when you're stuck indoors. And one of the things that I'm finding is we're talking more at our house. We're spending a little more time around the table together. And it is a great, great thing. So I want to encourage you during this time to know that things are going to get better. They're going to get better. And we're going to celebrate what we've got right now. And we're going to look forward with anticipation to what's ahead. Because we know that God's got this. He's not surprised by this. This isn't something that caught him unawares or off guard. He knew it was coming, and we're just going to trust that the Lord will see us through. And as we do that this morning, I'm going to invite you to join me in turning in your Bibles, if you've got them there, to Numbers chapter 13. And we're going to look at some great words this morning that are going to help us talk about trusting the Lord in times of difficulty. This will be the last message that I preach in this Faith Overcoming Fear series. Next week, we're going to dive into Palm Sunday and then Easter the week after that. But today, I want to just take a few moments to talk to you about trusting the Lord with all your heart, leaning not on your own understanding, in all your ways acknowledging Him, and knowing that as you do that, He will direct your paths. Number chapter 13, we come to some interesting words in the Old Testament story of the children of Israel. The children of Israel have left Egypt. They have been wandering and heading north through the Dead Sea region towards the Galilee, and God has been guiding and directing them, and they've made this journey with anticipation and expectation of what's going to be there for them when they inherit the land. And when they get to the land, we read in Numbers chapter 13, verse 2, that the Lord brought them to a place where God said, "Send out for yourself men so that they may spy out the land of Canaan, which I'm going to give to the sons of Israel. You'll send a man from each of your father's tribes, every one a leader among them." Now, let me just kind of set the stage here. They're at a place called Kadesh Barnea. It sits on the eastern side of the Jordan River, basically across from the city of Jericho. It's a beautiful place. It's a wonderful place. It's the place from which Israel will move out of the wandering time into the land of promise. At this point in their journey, they have been walking, it's about 12 or 13 days from Mount Sinai up to Kadesh Barnea, and they're there. They're excited about what's ahead. They're believing in God for this promise. And the Lord says to Moses, send some spies in to bring back a report and to let people know what's ahead. So we jump over to verse 25, where it says, when they'd returned from spying out the land at the end of 40 days, they proceeded to come to Moses and to Aaron, to all the congregation of the sons of Israel in the wilderness of Paran at Kadesh, and they brought back word to them and to all the congregation and showed them the fruit of the land. Now that's a big, long, hairy verse that basically says this. They wandered for 40 years through the promised land, took a good look at it, brought back some goods from it, and now are standing giving a report. And this is what they tell them, verse 27. We went into the land where you sent us, Moses, and it certainly does flow with milk and honey, and this is its fruit. Now, I want to stop right there for just a moment. They've gone into the land. It is everything they dreamed it would be and more. It's an amazing place. They've brought back clusters of grapes and citrus and bananas and all of the fruit of the land. It is something to behold. But notice what happens in verse 28. Nevertheless, the people who live in the land, they're strong. Their cities are fortified and large. And moreover, we saw the descendants of Anak there. Amalek was living in the land of the Negev, and the Hittites and the Jebusites and the Amorites are living in the hill country, and the Canaanites are living by the sea and by the side of the Jordan. Those words produced a sense of fear and question and wonder. One of the things that the children of Israel have said since they've left Egypt so many times is, have you brought us out here just to perish? Maybe it'd be better if we go back to Egypt. And this is another one of those stories that no doubt produces in their minds those same thoughts. But notice verse 30. Caleb, one of the spies, quieted the people before Moses. And listen to what he says. We should by all means go up and take possession of it, for we shall surely overcome it. What a statement of faith. But the men who had gone up with him said, we're not able to go up against the people. They're too strong for us. So they gave out to the sons of Israel a bad report of the land which they had spied out, saying, the land through which we've gone in spying it out is a land that devours its inhabitants, and all the people whom we saw in it are men of great size. There also we saw the Nephilim, the son of Anak, or part of the Nephilim, and we became like grasshoppers in our own sight, and so we were in theirs. What a picture. Everything was set for them to enter into the land of promise. God had said they would be there. God had told them that there would be wonder and beauty and power and blessing there. But something brought them to a place where they just said, you know, it's not what we thought it would be. Have you ever noticed how there are times in life you go through things and you think they're going to be one thing, and you believe that God was leading you this direction and it was going to be a wonderful, blessed thing, and you get there and it's just not what you thought it would be. Things were a little bit different. Things were a little bit harder to grasp hold of, and things were a little bit more challenging. It was like you were expecting that this bowl of cherries would be nothing but cherries, but there are a few pits in the cherries, and you're struggling with it, and you're not sure what to do or where to go. And so rather than seizing the opportunities, you just kind of step back and say, I'm not sure this is everything I want. And that's where they were. Now, it's interesting that Moses gave to these spies some really clear instructions. When you go back to verse 17 through verse 20, it's interesting. He says, I want you to look for what the land was like. I want you to ask the question, are the people strong or weak? Are they many or few? Is the land good or is it bad? Are the cities open camps or fortified cities? Is the land fat or lean? Does it produce more or little? Are there trees in the land? Is there fruit? Everything that Moses asked them to spy out was basically the stuff they would need to know to settle. None of those questions had anything to do with the question of whether or not it was possible to enter into the land. All of the questions had to deal with how we would settle once we get there. What are we going to find when we cross the river and enter into the land? But you know, I think the spies missed that. I think the spies struggled with what they'd been asked to do. They didn't really follow the directions. And we find that after the 40 days, they come back and they say very quickly that this land is amazing and fruitful. The people were strong. The cities were fortified. But there were giants there. And of all the things that they would highlight, three reflecting what they were asked to find out, and one, the source becomes the source of their fear. And it's interesting in that moment, that's what they gravitate to. Now, when they say they're giants in the land, the sons of Anak were a unique breed of people. Historians say they stood somewhere between 8 and 9 feet tall. It would be kind of like my little grandson Landon standing next to Dave McMullen here in the church. Sure, it would make you feel like a grasshopper in their sight. But the question wasn't whether or not there were giants in the land. The question was, what kind of land is it? How are we going to settle it? What are the places and the things that we're going to see and experience and have there? And even though they saw those things, their vision was quickly blinded, and they gravitated towards the one negative thing they experienced in the land. Isn't that the story of life? We see all that God provides, but there are other things that get our eyes off the promises and the provisions, and those things become our focus. And they become the things that turn our faith into fear. Caleb made an incredible statement of faith. He said, we should by all means take possession of what God has provided. And in the face of the absence of faith in the eyes of the other spies, Caleb said that faith will overcome the obstacle. We should by all means enter in. COVID-19 is a formidable foe. It's our contemporary sons of Anak. It's bigger than anyone could have imagined and bigger than anyone really could prepare for, and it's far-reaching, more far-reaching than anyone might have thought possible. Its effect is horrific and its damage significant. And the one thing that it does is produce incredible fear. That's where a lot of people are living today. That's where a lot of folks are struggling. Well, we see it everywhere we go. The medical gloves and the masks on people's faces, the distance that people are making, and they're being incredibly careful, and all of those things are necessary and important. But the giant doesn't have the power to overtake us unless we let it. Sunday school class this morning, Pastor John shared an interesting thought, and it just kind of grabbed me, and I see it in light of the word this morning that the worst that could happen to us is we get the disease and we die. Now, I'm not going to be flippant about that. That's a horrible thing. But recognize that as followers of Jesus Christ, that's not a bad thing. Paul said, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. He went on to say, you know, it's better for me if I die and go on to be with the Lord, but it's better for you if I hang around and take care of you. And he chose to stay, and I'm choosing to stay, and I'm praying that you're choosing to stay, but that means that we don't let the disease, the giant, overcome us. We do the things that are necessary to protect our health. We take care of the things in our homes to make sure that they're clean and sanitized. We watch out where we go and who we hang out with and how close we get to them. We do all of the necessary things, and the giant more than likely won't get to us. But for that to be truth, we have to overcome the fear. What would it have taken for the Israelite spies to come to the same conclusion as Caleb? Let me share with you a few things, and then we're going to wrap up this morning by looking at some points of application for us. The first thing I think they should have done to make certain that they came to the same conclusion as Caleb was to trust in what they knew. They knew that God was with them. They knew that God had brought them thus far. They knew that God's will was to give them a land. He had promised that over and over and over again to their people. But now in the face of trusting him to provide, they turned their sight elsewhere. And they begin to look at the things that can produce fear and difficulty, and they give in to those things. I want to suggest to you this morning that in times like these, trust is absolutely essential. Moses had told them what to look for. Moses had told them what to seek out. Moses had told them what to study. And none of those things carried with them the question, can we enter the land? But all of them amplified the realization that this is going to be what we see when we get into the land. But they looked beyond the command. They looked to the side of the expectation. And they lost their trust. If they just could have trusted, they could have come to the same conclusion as Caleb. But to trust meant they would have to listen to what they were told. The directions Moses gave were crystal clear. They didn't include anything that would produce fear-mongering. There was nothing in the directions that would say, there's too much here for us to deal with. Moses spoke in his day, and I think he spoke as others are speaking in our day, that if we'll listen, we will know what it will take to overcome. How could it be that these spies could go in and 11 of them would come back and they would say, oh no, the giants are too big, but one among them, Caleb, who would listen very carefully, said, we should just go in, we will overcome. He understood that everything that was asked of them was focused on the question of what are we going to encounter when we're there. And so listening to what he was told, he said, let's go, folks. Let's make this happen. That would require, though, that we do what we're told. That's the big one. Following the directions could have brought victory to those at Kadesh Barnea in Numbers 13. But because they chose to do something different, it set them up for disaster. Later in the word, we'll read that everyone aged 21 and below who stood at the riverbank that day and heard that word from the spies and believed it, everyone aged 21 and below would perish, die over the next 40 years as they wandered in the desert. It's amazing to me that from Mount Sinai, where they were told of the land of promise, to Kadesh Barnea was just a 12-day journey. But they would wander for 40 years, and generations would die because they didn't do what they were told to do. Disobedience set them up for disaster. Which brings me to the last step that the spies could have taken to come to the same conclusion as Caleb, and that is just to follow the will of the Lord and not waver along the way. When the word says that he will direct our paths, I shared that in the very start of the service today from Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6, that if we trust in the Lord with all of our heart and lean not on our own understanding, in all our ways acknowledge him, he will direct our paths. If we follow and not waver along the way, we know that God will bring us to the preferred place that he has for every one of us. But it requires that we follow his direction. It requires that we trust in what we know. It requires that we listen to what we're told, that we do what we're told to do. Because the moment we look to the side, to the left or to the right, the moment we consider other options, we set ourselves up for failure. And our faith is turned into fear. In all of life, we face obstacles that will do their best to take us down and turn our faith into fear. But folks, that's not God's plan for us. It isn't, and it certainly doesn't have to be. So how do we adapt these truths this morning to face life and live out a faith that overcomes fear? What are the things that you and I have to do this morning as we confront COVID-19 or any other obstacle, any other giant in the land that seeks in our minds to undo the plan of God and what he has for us? Well, let's take those four same things and look at them and see what the word says. First of all, we have to learn to trust. Trust that God really is with us always. I love Deuteronomy 31:6. I introduced it a week or two ago to you along with a little chorus from a Dennis Jernigan song that says, "Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or tremble at them, for the Lord your God is the one who goes with you. He will not fail you or forsake you." Now, folks, that's easy to trust in. Because when we walk with the Lord, we recognize that those words become for us a source of certainty and expression. We don't have to be afraid. We don't have to tremble. We can be strong and we can be courageous because God is with us and his word says he will not fail us or forsake us. Now, I want to stop there a minute and say there are some in the land who would say something like this: he might fail you. He might forsake you. He might choose to let you hang out on your own. No, the word doesn't say that. It says he will not. It's an emphatic, and he does not ever leave us alone. So this morning, I encourage you to trust him. No matter the battle you're facing, no matter the mountain you're trying to climb, the valley you're trying to get through, no matter where you're at, whatever giant is in the land around you, before you, trust in the Lord, and know this morning that he'll see you through. There's a second adaption, and that is that we listen. Psalm 119, verse 105 says, "His word is a light unto your feet and a light unto your path." I want to challenge you during these days to listen to the word of the Lord. I have been really intentional lately about spending time in God's word. It's a big deal to me. It's a big deal to understand
that God is with us. And in times of uncertainty or difficulty or trial or tribulation, his word speaks into the middle of that and says to us, be strong and take courage. His word really is a light to our feet and a lamp to our path. And if we'll just listen to his word and let it soak in, it will give us faith that vanquishes fear. And it'll give us the strength that we need to press on through. We also need to do the things God asks of us. Faith demands action. And if we fail to act, we fail. James chapter 2, verse 17 says, faith without works is dead. During these days when life is different, you and I are going to be given opportunities to do things that we maybe wouldn't have taken time to do otherwise. We'll be given time to spend more time in his word. I challenge you to do it. We'll be given time to spend more time in prayer. I challenge you to do it. We'll be given time and opportunities to reach out to people around us, maybe by phone or by text or by email or by video, however you can connect with people. I encourage you to do it. We're going to be given opportunities to be more intentional about our faith, and I challenge you to do it. Because the reality is, this is not a time where we sit back and we say, woe is us, because some pandemic has said we can't do anything. The exact opposite is true. Praise God, because of this pandemic, we can do all sorts of things. Because right now around you, there are people, maybe next door, maybe down the street, maybe one of your family members, maybe a coworker, maybe a friend, I don't know, who, though they don't know Christ yet, they are living with questions and uncertainty and fear that you could speak into and give them hope and give them help, but you're going to have to do it. Because the reality is this, we probably will never have a greater opportunity to reach a lost and broken world than we have right now. This pandemic opens a door of opportunity for us into the hearts of people who are questioning, what is this going to mean for me? And they're dealing with the questions of eternity. As we see on the news every day, and as much as we hate to see it, the number of cases going up and the number of deaths going up, those things can produce all kinds of fear and question and uncertainty. And on the one hand, I think that's good. Because the more questions it produces, the more opportunity we have to share the love and the grace and the hope that is found only in Jesus. So do it. And then finally, follow. Follow the word and the will and the way of the Lord in doing and in listening and in trusting every step of the way. Psalm 37:23 declares that the steps of the righteous are ordered of the Lord. For me, what that means is that God has marked out my path for this day. When I got up this morning, he had some things with intention he wants me to accomplish. And I have to live close enough to him and listen intently enough to him that as I step into my day and go about all of the things that I need to do, I follow his path, not mine, so that my faith can overcome all of the fear that's around me. Four words that make overcoming possible: trust, listen, do, follow. They were keys for Caleb. And they can be keys for you too as you live out a faith that overcomes fear. The question is, will you do it? Will you let God be God and help you to simply trust that in these days you will know that His grace is sufficient for all of your needs? Let's take a moment this morning, wherever you are worshiping, and go to the Lord in prayer. If you're seated around the table with your family or on the couch with your spouse or wherever you are, I just encourage you maybe to grab hands with those that you're with, and let's just bow in His presence this morning. I'm going to guide you in a few thoughts and prayers, and then I'll close out our time in the end, but let's just come into His presence and let Him speak to us this morning as our faith overcomes our fears. Father God, we come before You this morning so thankful that Your grace is always more than sufficient. You're an amazing God. These are tough days. I'm the first one to admit it. These days have redefined my entire life, the way I do ministry, the places I go, the people I see, the things that I do. It's literally changed everything for me, and it's created this new curve of learning and understanding of how to live. And God, in the midst of it, I'm thankful that You're with me. This morning, Lord, as we come to prayer, I just want to ask that You would hear us as we ask You to help us to trust, Lord. And if there are places in our lives this morning where we're struggling to trust, God, I pray right now as we take a few moments in the silence to pray with those around us, I just pray, God, that You would help us to confess those places and in this moment to begin trusting You. Hear our prayers, Lord. God, one of the hardest things to do in these recent days has been to be able to listen. The media is screaming all kinds of messages, and everybody thinks they know everything, and everybody's sharing all kinds of insights and stuff of what's happening and who's got it and who doesn't and how they're getting it and all those things, and it creates confusion and chaos. Would You just help us this morning to shut all those voices out and to listen to You? And right now, God, as we take a moment in the silence, would You speak to us a word from Your word that brings to us a sense of peace and assurance, God, that You're with us? Father, there are some intentional things that we can do during these days. Folks that we can reach out to by telephone or by a letter or by an email or by a text. Would You help us around our tables this morning or wherever we're worshiping? Would You help us just to take a pen and a pencil and write down the names that You bring to mind right now that You want us to touch base with? Just to encourage, just to talk, just to share, just to maybe even pray with. Would You help us to do something, Lord, to reach them today? Give us those names as we take a few moments in the silence to hear from You. And now, Lord, we ask that You'd help us to follow. That we could have the faith of Caleb that says, you know, who cares what the giants are in the land? We're just going to press on in. We're going to allow you, God, to give us the grace that overcomes, the strength that gives victory, the courage that stands strong, the stuff that enables us not to tremble or be afraid. We're going to follow you, Lord. And in these days, we're just going to let you lead us and guide us and direct us that, God, we at the end of the journey and the end of this battle could say, we celebrate the victory of the Lord. Grant us faith that overcomes fear. And help us this day to remember that you really are with us. In the strong name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. We thank you this morning for gathering with us for worship. And this morning, we're just going to take and ask that the Lord would be with each of you in these days ahead and keep you in the hollow of his hand. Help us, Lord, we're just going to ask the Lord to help us to trust, to listen, to do, to follow, and to know that God in these days, the God that brings to us victory and hope and faith in the midst of the journey, we're going to trust that he's going to see us all through. If you have anything that you need this week, if you need groceries, you're in that 60 and above crowd and need some groceries or medication, don't hesitate to call the church office tomorrow. Remember that at 11 o'clock, Teen Sunday School class begins, and then at 1 o'clock, Trudy Rathman's class begins. A quick word to just say that you don't have to be in the classes to join the classes. We've got an 8:30 class, an 11 o'clock teen class, and a 1 o'clock adult class. You can plug into one or all three of those if you just want to spend some time with the people of the church. We're glad to have you and just encourage you to step in and do that. But this week, we're just going to pray for you and ask that God gives you a great, great week of victory as we overcome all of the things that might produce in us fear. May the Lord be with you. May his grace overshadow you. May his comfort and his peace keep you. God bless. Have a great week.